Welcome back. In the last video, we made a data set in SuiteAnalytics. In this video, we're gonna be taking a look at workbooks, and specifically, we're gonna be making a pivot table using the data set that we made in the previous video. So let's take a look at this. So we're on our homepage, we're gonna go back to this analytics tab. And in the previous video, I showed you the data sets, but now we're gonna go back to workbooks. And again, you'll remember I talked about data sets being like wood or that raw materials, and then workbooks is like the carving. So we're gonna carve up this data set and the information that we put in there to get the visual representation of the data that we want. So the first thing before we make a workbook, I just need to comment on all of these template workbooks that we have down here. So these just come with the NetSuite edition. Based on the one that you have, you might have more or less available. You can use these if they fit your needs, but generally, when you're making a workbook in SuiteAnalytics, you're generally gonna wanna do something very specific. Like you might wanna look up credit memos in a specific time that are over a certain amount in a specific location. So you have that exact precision that you need with SuiteAnalytics. The odds that one of these templates is gonna fit that exact need is pretty low. One thing that I do recommend though is if you peruse, especially as you get familiar with SuiteAnalytics, if you take a look at the templates, you might get ideas for other ways of grouping information or formatting or highlighting things that they use in the templates that you can actually use in some of your own workbooks. So it's not completely unhelpful, but in general, I find it's rare that you have an instance where the templates are useful for your own needs. One thing to keep in mind though is once you make a workbook, they will be stored on this page. So the workbook we're gonna be making in this video, when you wanna access it in the future, you'll actually sift through here and it's alphabetical. You find the one that you want and you can open it up and make changes to it, etc. So in this instance, we're gonna go over here to create a new workbook. So we'll click on that button. And the first thing it's asking us is what is the data set that we're grabbing from? And you can actually grab multiple data sets, but in this case, we made one specific one. So we're gonna grab this transaction data set test one. And it brings us to this page, which is really like our staging area for making this workbook. And first off, we need to select what type of visual representation do we want for our workbook. And you can pick several, meaning when you make this workbook, you can actually add several different visual representations, and I'll show you how we do that here. But before we actually make a pivot table, I do want to just show you how it works with a table, which is simpler. And you'll see as I click on it, it really just gives you an open space here that we can drop information into. So in a way, a table really doesn't have anything much further than what we had in the data set. In fact, it's really just gonna be whatever we wanna take out of the data set and put into a table, we have that option. So if you had a data set with 40 different fields linked in that data set, you might make three different tables, and each table, you simply grab certain fields from the data set and you have these unique tables. So let's bring in some fields such as customer. Okay, so the customer fields populates, and we could also add, let's say, total amount. And we could also add the date, which would be relevant. And again, they just automatically populate in this instance. So we've got the customer date and total amount, and maybe we wanna now change the name of this table. So we can go up here and double click on this table and click invoices by customer. One more thing I wanna add before we move on to pivot tables is the fact that if this data set is lacking a field that we need for our either table or pivot table, we can actually go to the data set here. We can click on these three dots and it'll say open data set. So if we click on that, it actually brings us back to that data set and gives us the ability to make those modifications. So let's say we want to add the status of the invoice to our results and be able to have that as a field. So I can click status up here and you'll see in the search results, we've got transaction status. So that's the simplest one that we want. We're going to draw that in. Automatically populates it in here, and we're gonna hit save. So we're now saving this edition of status. It tells us it's saved, and we can apply to workbook. So it's gonna bring that information straight back to the workbook we were already in. So we can see over here, we have status available, and we can now drop that straight into our table. The same thing applies to pivot tables. You can do it as well as in the charts. You can just add them as you want. So now that we have this table as we want, I'm gonna hit this plus symbol. And in doing so, I haven't gotten rid of or even saved that original table, but I now have the ability to create an additional item within this workbook. So now we're gonna get into pivot tables. So I click on pivot table. So what we're looking at here, again, this is our staging area. So we're gonna have our columns up here, our rows on the left here, and then this is gonna be the fields, the information that we have in the middle. So we can see here, this is a representation of what we have here, right? The rows that we have here, the columns here, and then the fields themselves, which they list as measures, is down here. And then we of course have our data set over here. So this is what we're gonna be drawing from. So let's say we wanna add customer, which again, that field is actually called entity, but we renamed it in the data set. So it says customer, and we're gonna drop that in our rows. Again, it gives us, for this specific, we create a pivot table. So it's again asking us, are you sure you wanna look at the child level information? And we're gonna say, yes, we do, and don't ask the question again, and we'll hit apply. So we've added customer to the rows, and then we're gonna go date in the columns. Now, we've added them here, but notice nothing changed here. So we actually have to go over here to hit refresh. And you'll see it pops up, but notice, even though it's got customer here and date, it doesn't actually populate with any information. And the reason is that we haven't set what the measure is. So the measure, in this case, we're gonna add total amount. In most instances, the measure is gonna be something, some quantity. That might be a quantity of items. Oftentimes, it's gonna be some sort of a currency or an amount value. So in this case, we're gonna add total amount, and we're gonna drop that in the measures field. And now when we hit refresh, we get this pivot table that shows us all our customers. And then by year, if we wanted to drill down into month, day, et cetera, we have the ability to do so by hitting these plus symbols. I'm gonna get a little more into that in the next video, but you can see here, 2023, we have all these amounts tied to these customers. And if we scroll down further, we'll see that there's a few also included in 2022. And we'll see that the various currencies are shown here. And you can change various formatting. I'll show you in a little bit. How you could affect the currency, the way that that thing is displayed. But we have a basic pivot table now. So here's where it gets really interesting with pivot tables. We can now add additional elements into this table. So for example, let's say we wanna have not just customer, but also within customer, we wanna see the invoices. So the invoices are really these document numbers. So we're gonna take that and we're gonna drag it over to customer. And we've placed it underneath the customers. So that's important because if we have it the other way around, whichever one's on top is gonna take precedence in the hierarchy. So we've got document number here under customer, and if we hit refresh for that, so we've got the customer here and we've got all the various invoices related to that customer as well as the various amounts tied to that. So before we simply had all of these invoices were being sort of grouped under the customer and we were just seeing that total summation of all those invoice values. Now we have them broken down. We can do the same thing up here with the columns. Let's say we want to add location. So I'm going to put location in here. And if I hit refresh on that, so you can see within each year, for example, in 2022, there was only two locations that invoices were recorded with. Whereas 2023, if we roll this out, you can see we have all these different locations in which the invoices were specified. And again, we can clarify that date even more granularly. So to now kind of get into the point of formatting. So if we click on, for example, the formatting here, and specifically I'm doing it for measures because that's the information that's actually in the field. So if we want to format that information with things like highlights, etc., you need to make sure you're clicking on the dots for this specific one, not one of these ones up here. So with clicking on amount, we have two ways to format. We can click on format right here, and it gives us all these different options. I'm not gonna go through all of these, but if we click this override button, we can do things like take away the decimal places. We can show how negative values are shown. We can do things like having the currency symbol be a certain way that it's shown, or even go after the number, whatever your preference is. And it's not just for currency, but things for integers, decimals, percentages. So that's fine. We'll hit okay on that. And then one additional formatting tool I want to show you is conditional formatting, which if we go to manage conditional formatting, and if you remember from the save search video I did on highlighting, it's a very similar thing. We can specify, so we're dealing with the amount, right? We have total amount up here. And I can say, for example, greater or equal to, let's say $500 in this case. and I can specify the color that it's gonna highlight if it's over $500. So let's just say yellow, and I can also add symbols. So let's say I want a little yellow arrow pointing at it, and this will apply to subtotals and grand totals. Now, I'm not actually gonna hit apply on this particular one just because I know the fact that this is currency that's not just dollars, but also pounds and other things, it'll actually not be able to work with that. But if you set the criteria to be specific to one currency, if you hit save on that, you would see, like for example, I specified it at $500, all of these fields would suddenly have a yellow background and they'd have the little arrow pointing at it. So it can be a very useful tool for various highlighting. Now, there is definitely more options. You can see other buttons up here. You can do things, of course, like invoices by. But for the sake of this video, I just wanna keep it very simple. We're not gonna go into every single little option you have. I'm just gonna touch on a couple more key features. You do have export. You can see export to SDF. However, that's probably not what you want. Probably what you're looking for is to do this export data to a CSV file. Just keep in mind that in most instances, especially if you have a lot of joins going on in your pivot table, it might not come out exactly how you're planning in the CSV file. NetSuite has made improvements to that export function, but again, depending on its complexity, it might not come out exactly how you want it. You might have to remove fields to achieve the correct export that you're looking for. And then lastly, we're gonna hit save on this. It's gonna ask us, what is this workbook? Now keep in mind, this is not just the pivot table we've made, but also the table we made prior to that. So we're gonna name this entire workbook and we're gonna say, invoices test one. And again, you should add a description so anyone looking at this workbook can easily tell what its purpose is. So we'll hit save on that. And it gives us a little indication that it has saved. And that's it for making a basic pivot table in SuiteAnalytics. In the next video, I'm gonna show you how to make a chart. So I'll see you there.